Hi, in this video I want to address the importance of the nervous system from a relational perspective. There appears to be an ongoing confusion among even medical specialists as to what's happening in terms of the body, brain, and mind interaction. The project that has remained unfinished for 100 plus years, I believe now today, can be completed. When people ask me, are you a Freudian? I usually say to them, no, I'm not a Freudian. I'm not a neo-Freudian. I am a clinical neuroscientist. And by that I mean that I want to see how the project that began over 100 years ago, and maybe even further back, on how to produce real change in people's lives can take place on the neural integration level. How we can do that in terms of combining the best of relational science, and I would also include the best of neuroscience. It seems that a number of things have started our path and in the direction that we are today. Typically, I hear patients tell me that they, when they're sick, they usually the first place they go to is see their local physician. And of course, I'm not opposed to that at all. I believe that that's a good first place to go. But it appears that we in the culture continue to want to split treatment into what's psychological, what's scientific, what's medical, and what isn't. For example, I have a friend of mine who's a major physician in our area, and he called me one afternoon and said, hey, Dr. Arch, I want to refer a patient to you. And I said to him, Dr. John, I need a partner. Would you like to come in and help me out to deal with the patients that I deal with? And he goes, no, I'm not so good at all that psychological stuff. And I said to him, what would you do if I said, Dr. John, that relationships involve medical substrates, that emotions are medical, they're neuronal, they're neurobiological? And he said to me, I have no idea what you're talking about, and that's why I'm sending people to you. I'm not in medical school anymore, Arch, and that's why I want people to see you instead of seeing me. I said, we both laughed on the phone, and I said, I get it. Okay, let's make an appointment. I'll call the patient. You see, the radical part of what I'm suggesting is that if we really think about what's happening in the brain, mind, and body, let's think of it in terms of a holistic approach, an H-O-L-I-S-T-I-C, a holistic approach that the way that modern science and the way that modern people think of what's happening in our bodies and our brains, they tend to not really understand that really that we're one piece, that we're one unit. And then when that unit begins to dysregulate, then we begin to see the kind of problems that we're describing today. And that's what I want to address in this very brief video. So let's start back. If we think in terms of over 100 years ago in Europe, as I mentioned in the previous videos, in the neuroscientific ones, that a time period about 1860, thereabouts, and for about 20 years, that the best, historically, the best geniuses, the best doctors to train with would have been in Paris. And doctors like Charcot and Breuer and people like that. This is where the cutting edge type of neuroscience, neurology was taking place. Of course, it was a very big period of disarray. In other words, the technology still hadn't developed yet that we have today. Of course, there's no neuroimaging. There's none of that high-tech brain imaging at all going on. So can you imagine what it was like for doctors who were beginning to treat patients and doing their best? These were neurologists. These were medical doctors. They were doing their darndest to try to find out what's really going inside of individuals. And so at that point, and later in the around 1865 thereabouts, that the project that I'm describing today, that I believe that we can complete, this unfinished project, can now be finished. And what is the project? In my two books, I call it The Talking Cure. If you'd like to look at those, they're available, look them up. The Talking Cure is not just telling people what to do. It's not just about giving people information, which would include all that, but it involves how to rewire people, how to get into the human nervous system and begin to rearrange those types of things that are going on in my life and in your life, and to do it on a neuronal level. Imagine what that's like. Now let me just say briefly that there's a lot of pop stuff out there, whether it's pop psychology, whether it's pop science. It tends to be very reductionistic. It tends to be very reified. Those are big words in the world of modern medicine and modern philosophy of science. And what it means is, how do you verify that? How do you quantify that? Or when we tend to look at, like, a brain cell, we tend to look at the nervous system. Today there's a lot of discussion about the amygdala, the hippocampus. The hippocampus is our memory system. The amygdala is our fight, flight, faint, freeze system. It's our danger detection unit, and it's in every mammal, every vertebrae that this fight, flight system tends to become activated and is present in these, even in these vertebrates. So the idea is, what do we do with this? So when I talk to fellow doctors, or if I'm talking to fellow therapists or analysts, they may say, oh yeah, I was talking to a patient who is really, they're stuck in the amygdala, whether they're a borderline patient or maybe they're anxious patients, have panic disorder. They talk about the amygdala, and when I'm listening to them speak, it's like they've really quantified it. They really go, aha, I really understand what's going on now, because I can somewhat specify what part of the brain that's malfunctioning. Now, this is what the doctors did back in the 1860s. They said, we have to find a way to understand this, what's going on in the nervous system and what's going on in the body. So in our world of neuroscience and clinical analysis, the discussion of patients who might have what's called a conversion disorder, or someone who's called who has a somatoform disorder. And these words basically mean that the patients, and this is probably 80% of the patients that are going to see their physicians about, that these are patients who struggle with stomach problems, whether it's irritable bowel syndrome, whether it's chronic fatigue, whether, whatever it is, stomach aches, some even develop Crohn's disease, many of these cases that would fall under the somatoform. And the cases are just very complex. And so over 100 years ago, these would have been discussed, and then the terms would have been developed that we now call conversion disorders or somatoform disorders. So there's that old joke in the medical world, and the person, she's always complaining that she's sick, and she's always going to the doctor because she's sick. Well, on her tombstone, the words go, when she dies, it says, see, I told you I was sick. Well, these would be the patients that are dealing with a lot of bodily problems, bodily states, or typically the patient who has chronic migraines or chronic distress, always having to take medications for headaches and things like that. As a lawyer friend told me recently, he asked me about this particular medication, and I said, well, why are you asking? He said, well, my mom was on this medication all throughout her life. And I said, really? Why did she do that? He said, she always complained about headaches. She always had headaches. And I said, why did she always have headaches? What did her physician husband tell her? He said, because she had 5 kids. And we both, of course, chuckled and laughed and things like that. And my thought was, wow, so your mom, it was on major tranquilizers all of your life. He says, well, that's why I'm crazy after all. And so we laughed. I said, we should talk more about this sometime. The setting, of course, wasn't, the drop-in wasn't the time and place to talk about these kinds of things. So the project that I'm describing, the incomplete project, the project that talking to people, learning how to relate to people, deeply connecting with people, and to do it at a brain and neuronal level can now be completed today. And I think that's the project, that's the scientific project that we can finish today, that was not possible in previous generations. I was at last Thanksgiving, I was at Costco, and I saw a sign that said $12.95 for pumpkin cheesecakes. So I thought, hey, this would be great. I'm going to go grab some, grab a couple, give some away for Thanksgiving, and take a couple home. And I have a sweet tooth for cheesecake sometimes. And so as I headed for the bin, the ice bin where all the pumpkin cheesecakes were, a bunch of people just came out of nowhere, out of the woodwork, and they began to trample me and push me aside. And I was only able to grab one pumpkin cheesecake out of the bin, which was full, maybe 100 at least pumpkin cheesecakes. And I was quite bewildered by what had just happened. And so one of the managers, the Costco manager, she came up to me and said, "Hey, Doc, we're sorry we didn't have more pumpkin cheesecakes." She says, "You know, we make all of these here." And I said, "Really? Well, that's good to know, but can I make a suggestion?" She said, by the way, she said, "Well, we didn't make that many this year, this Thanksgiving." And I said, "Well, can I make a suggestion?" And she said, "Sure, absolutely. Tell the bakers that next year and during the holidays to maybe double their production of pumpkin cheesecakes. And maybe summer is not the time to have it, but maybe the holidays, Christmas and Thanksgiving would be a perfect time to produce pumpkin cheesecakes." What's the point of that story? The point of the story is that more and more today, and I'll address this in further videos, more and more today, because of the scientific project that's been dormant for 100 plus years, the project to integrate the brain and the body to create that reconnection on neural levels from subcortical to cortical states, that project can now be complete. And that, again, for upcoming video, is that the somatosensory places, the brain mapping, how the brain maps what's going on in the body in terms of interoception and what's happening outside the body is mapped in the different regions of the brain that we can now see. There's two different areas, and I'll speak to those later, maybe in the next video. But the point is that we need production from upstairs and downstairs. So the upstairs would be the cortical, and the downstairs would be the production. And think of the brain as a duplex. So if there's not a communication between the upstairs and the downstairs, or the downstairs and the upstairs, then we might be overproducing pumpkin cheesecakes, especially maybe during the summer. Maybe there's not a great demand for that during the summertime, but I would suggest during the holidays. I hope you do like pumpkin cheesecakes, but over the holidays, we need to have a good production. And that message needs to be taking place, that to produce the X amount of pumpkin cheesecakes, that message has to come from the top, from the management, and it has to go down to the production. Now, what's happening now, more than ever, is that we now know, beyond any doubt, that what drives the production of cheesecakes is a bottom-up approach. Whereas I think in our modern Western world, of modern science, modern neuroscience, modern medicine, it's more of a top-down approach. And I think that that's a mistake. And I will deal with this in upcoming videos, where children are actually born without a cerebral cortex because there's a stroke in the uterus, and these are hydrocephalic children, and that they can function, they can do a lot of things, but they're not able to function as well without the upstairs. The upstairs has been tragically removed because of the stroke, the virus that attacked the nervous system. So what these studies like this that were discovered even in the late 40s showed doctors like me is that there's something going on that's a bottom-up approach. And the bottom-up approach then has been maybe a conspiracy theory, but the suppression, the science has been suppressed up until the late 40s, up until today, that what happens for me and you in terms of what we do automatically, what we do consciously, is really all about automation. And that 95% of what we do is pretty automatic. Unless I come to a big city to see you, I'm not so up on Minneapolis, I may not know how to get around. I've got a couple of friends that can take me through the Twin Cities. I know my way quite well around LA or London or New York. I can get around well in Florida as well, but see, I can do most things automatically, and that's what I call automation. And that's what the downstairs does. The downstairs will produce a lot of pumpkin cheesecakes, if you think of the analogy, that most of what we do is coming from the bottom up. And that is what the scientists are beginning to discover. And the project was incomplete for the lack of scientific skills. So the bottom-up approach then is that the subcortical parts of the nervous system, from the brainstem to the polyvagal systems to then the amygdala, this is where consciousness occurs. This is what's driven by emotion. And that emotion has to be regulated, and it takes two to do that. The geneticists, Dr. Head discovered in the 40s, that when two brains fire together, they can rewire together, and they can survive together. So the talking cure is really all about learning how to do this together. I'm suggesting that when we learn how to relate together, that we can turn on healthy, regulated parts of our nervous system, and that the nervous system then sends out these signals, these text messages to the body, and that the body, from the top up, which is from the above the diaphragm, which is the myelinated areas, and that below the diaphragm are the non-myelinated systems. So if you think about this, that anything above the diaphragm is a faster acting, quicker moving, a more regulated system. And this is what we scientists mean by myelination. But anything below the diaphragm really depends on the speed and the regulation of these myelinated systems, and that it's a subcortical interaction. So if you put me through a lot of stress, and again, the stress science is also old. Now it's becoming very, very limited in what it can explain. The science that's typical in medical science today is that the science is that the stress is all from the outside coming in. So when I go see my doctor, my physician, she may say, keep the stress down, Arch, keep everything down, keep it low. When actually we can see in the brain, in the homeostatic area of the brain, which is again a subcortical area, when it's overloaded, then all these systems that are below, from the lower parts of the brain below, are starting to turn on. So my HPA axes, the hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenocorticoids, the vagal systems, the immune system, the heart rate, all these myelinated systems will either up-regulate, sensing danger when there's too much stress, when there's dysregulation, or they'll down-regulate in terms of shutting down and will not be able to regulate. So when I then go see my physician, and then I may be given a typical medication like prednisone or a steroid of some sort to continue to suppress the immune system, then but we potentially have a problem. As I talked to a heart patient who came to me from his cardiologist, who had him on prednisone for over 2 years. And I said, why does your cardiologist have you on prednisone for 2 years? And he said, I don't know. He said, would you call him for me and talk to him? I said, absolutely, I'll call him and let's talk. And you see, folks, the regulating the nervous system is the key, and that is the essence of the scientific project that I'm talking about that needs to be completed. But it can't just take place on a neuroscientific level. We need another aspect, a very central aspect, and that is what I would call the relational track. Now, what do I mean by that? There was a young lady, and she's a classic case in history. She was in Paris, in France, and she was in her 20s, and she is known in the clinical literature as Anna O. And Anna appears from the literature is that she kept things to herself. She kind of bottled up feelings and her thoughts. She kept her subjectivity to herself, what she believed, what she thought. But what, as it turns out, she was really crazy about a guy, that she loved the guy, and she told no one that whenever this guy would walk in the room, that her heart went pitter-patter. But she was hoping, she had these dreams that he was her knight in shining armor, her lover, her friend, and they developed a friendship, but she never shared how she really felt. And she had an older sister. And her older sister, as it turns out, how life is sometimes more tragic than orderly. Her sister then became deeply involved with this with this younger guy, older than her sister, and then unfortunately the two of them got married. Now, what is that like? What is that like when the guy that you're hoping would be your husband would be the guy of your dreams, that your sister marries him? And she had told no one. So then for the next 6 months thereabouts, that she was deeply distressed. She started to repress, started to, in our world today, we might call it disassociation. She started splitting, and she didn't like how she felt. She hated her sister, resentful. She hated the guy, how could he do such a thing? And she repressed all these feelings. And then something happened one day. Something tragic happened. Her sister was killed. Now, if you can imagine that, at what level of pain and anguish would that be? It was at that point when her sister was tragically killed. It was that Anna then became paralyzed. And as they would do, and we would do that today, they became paralyzed, and she was admitted into the hospital, one of the great hospitals in Paris. And for the next few weeks, as the medical laboratory reports tell us, if you take time to look at those, which I have, that Anna was deeply, deeply distressed, paralyzed as paralysis goes. Until one day a doctor took the time to be very interested in her case. Typically docs, you know, we don't have time to really spend a lot of excess time, extra time with patients to really talk to them about opening up. Well, what Anna did that day, which she had not done before, she began, after a few weeks, she became safe enough with this doctor that she began to open up her feelings. And she told this doctor about how she felt. And she explained to him all her resentment and just the pain and the rage that she was going through. And then after a few weeks of opening up, guess what happened? Her paralysis was gone. Her paralysis was gone. When I had just finished doing a lot of extensive work and research on Anna and her case, I had a patient had been referred to me by the neurology department at the local medical university, and they said, you need to see this patient. Her story was very similar to Anna's. She was having lunch one day with her folks at the university. Her older sister was visiting a university, and to take a very long story, with her permission, I'm making it very, very brief, that she fell over and began to have grand mal seizures. At the dinner table, imagine her older sister's taking off for college, and so then, as it turns out, she went to our local hospital. They did all the tests, they did all the workup. She went to another major university, did the workup there, and then she went pretty much the summer, all that summer, with the workup as to what's going on. And after 4 or 5 months of just intensive in and out of the hospital, intensive care, workups, and finally the head of the neurology department at the medical university called me and said, hey, I think that this would be a patient that you should see. I think I'm gonna make the referral arch. And so she came in, and so I began to see her a few times a week, and it began to dawn on me, this is my version of the Anna case. And that this girl could not go days without having grand mal seizures. And after many, many months of some intensive work, attempting to integrate the upstairs, downstairs, her pumpkin cheesecake analogy, getting her to open up, but realizing that opening up is not necessarily the cure. It took something more than that. I was wanting to move her systems, her medical systems, out of automation, that 95% of automation, what we all do, except when we're in new circumstances, in a new situation, a new city that we're not familiar with, where I think dysregulation and the bad wiring take place in our automated states. And it was at that point when I began to work with this young lady, I'll call her Susie, that after about 6 months of intensive work, Susie's now graduated from the university herself, and recently she just got married, and she's, from all what I'm hearing, she's doing incredibly well. Folks, the relational process is a neurobiological process, and learning how to be relational has incredible dividends. learning how to relate, how to be relational, is a neuroscientific phenomenon. And unfortunately, folks, we don't know how to do that. So when my friends say to me, how do we regulate you? How do we do that on a neuroscientific way with you? And I said, you don't know how to do it. You don't know how to do it. So I believe certain kinds of skills are necessary. We need to learn these skills, just like playing tennis, as Wimbledon is being shown on TV right now, and I'd love to go watch it, as these high-level trained professionals, men and women, are playing the game at the highest level. It appears that this kind of analogy should be taking place in our lives if we want to regulate the downstairs of the brain and the upstairs of the brain, the cortical and the subcortical states. And just one quick reminder is that the body is located, these soma centers, the Greek word for body, they're located inside the subcortical part of the brain. And now through very complicated neuroimaging, we can actually see that. We can see that if I'm thinking about what's going on inside of my body, then the different parts of the brain turn on through transcranial stimulation. Or when I'm thinking about outside the stress, those different systems in my brain are turning on as well. So learning how to talk together is a neuroscientific phenomenon. And at the heart of it is the reality of emotion. The reality of emotion. Now, two quick thoughts before we wrap up this video. One thought is I want to talk about attachment, and the other is I'll start with this one first, about how the right hemisphere is the center of the nervous system. We now know, and there's no doubt, this is not just Dr. Archie's opinion, that neuroscientifically, the right hemisphere is online at from 8 months to around 14, 15 months. We now know this beyond any doubt. And that the right hemisphere is doing all the work. The nervous system, a new nervous system is being developed. This is for Sylvie out there. God bless you. Sylvie now, she's going into her second month of development. She is now, her nervous system is beginning to become formulated. And that her mom then would be the primary caregiver. And that would be Nicole. She's the primary architect for this little girl's nervous system. So we now know at 8 months to about 14, 15 months, then we see a different sort of systems begin to emerge. Now the child develops, the infant develops different defense systems. So I know if you're going to connect with me, I can do this implicitly, I can do it through automation, I can do it very fast, and I know that if you're present for me, I know if you're in touch with me, if I need to sleep, do I need a potty change, do I need a diaper change, do I need something? And that the caregiver is in a deep interaction, a deep engagement with this infant. So what scientifically now we know that the left hemisphere, the talking brain, where Broca's area, where I can actually speak or I can understand language, these centers are not firing yet, because they're not online until about 2 years to 3.5 years. So even the brightest little kid on the planet can only speak about 70 words, according to a Harvard study, 70 words at the time she's 2 years old. But what is the right hemisphere doing? So the right hemisphere is fully online at about 2 years old, and the left hemisphere is not caught up yet until from 2 years to about 3.5 years. And what's exciting about this is that we can actually see now, once these two brains, I call them two brains, not two hemispheres, once these two brains are online from 3.5 to about 6, then we have explosive stuff going on, a lot of imprinting going on in terms of our caregivers and what kind of environment we have. I call it a bubble, I call it a safe place, a foxhole of sorts, where we need a very secure environment. And so we can feel safe and secure, and that leads us then into an attachment system. It was in the 50s that Sir John Bowlby went to London. He was a British doctor, a very amazing individual, and he presented before the International Congress about what he was beginning to see about primates and our need for attachment. We need to feel secure, we need to feel safe. And, of course, the scientists of the day, the major brainiacs on the planet, all over the world, said, you know, Dr. John, we're not really excited about what you're saying, because it sounds too sociological. It sounds like you're describing more the external environment. Of course, the doctors at the time did not know. They suspected, but they didn't know what we know today about the nervous system, and that there's a neurobiological phenomena taking place. So essentially what the attachment system and learning about attachment began to be put on the back burner. And it wasn't until the late 60s and 70s that a bunch of researchers from the United States went to London and trained with Dr. Bowlby, because they began to see that this is really an incredible time. This is an incredible time of learning. And we want to learn about this attachment system because it's very, very important. And so up until the 70s then we still didn't have a formulated understanding of what attachment is all about. But three particular types of attachment styles began to emerge from this research. One was called the insecure, one was called the ambivalent, and one was called the anxious. These were the prevailing three attachment styles. So how did scientists notice? So what the doctors would do back until the late 60s and the 70s, they would go into parents' homes with their permission, of course, and ask if we can do a study with your child from 14 months thereabouts. Let's see what they're doing in terms of their attachment style. So they developed this very complicated protocol, and so they would spend 2 hours a day, and they did this for somewhere around 15-16 weeks thereabouts, and then they told the parents after they were finished, come back and see me when your child is a little older, two and a half, maybe three, and let's follow up and let's do more studies and see what's going on in terms of their attachment style. So the objective was, we want to be secure, we don't want to be insecure, we want to avoid the ambivalence or the anxiousness that's taking place in the nervous system. So what these doctors did, my predecessors, what they did was they wanted to rule out any of the guesswork. They want to, you know, when I talk to my friends, how's your kids? Oh, they're doing great, they're doing wonderful. Well, you know, as someone who's trained in law, like I am too, I have a legal education, I'm thinking, well, that's hearsay. I don't really know for sure. But I want to, you know, I take it at face value. It's got to be true, because they seem to be very, very okay with that. But what these scientists did, they took the guesswork out of it, they took the hearsay out of it, and they saw for sure that the child, unless there's a secure attachment taking place, then the child will develop an insecure attachment style, an ambivalent, an anxious, avoiding attachment style. So then it wasn't until the 90s that one of my predecessors, I took my PhD in clinical psychology with a extra concentration in dynamic psychiatry. What my predecessors discovered was that there were two more. Not only were there three, but we had two more. And what they discovered, two more attachment styles, they discovered the disorganized and the dismissive attachment. What scientists like me call today, clinical scientists, the borderline personality, then that would be, he would be or she would be, their attachment style would be in the disorganized range. So again, this has been the protocol that's been well established and very, very grounded in clinical research. But what we were not able to do up until the late 90s was to take the attachment style and to put it together with a neurobiological and neuroscientific framework. So that's what I believe is the essence of a talking cure. In an upcoming book, I'm calling it the Kairos Cure. Kairos, K-A-I-O-R-S. That when we know how to do this together, we work in the moment, in the present, and we begin to see a transformation of the particular attachment style. Some of my professors, my former professors, would have taught me that within the first year of human life, that if I met your child, that I would be able to tell with about 90% accuracy what kind of attachment style do we have, does your child have, and do I have. And based on much clinical investigation that I've conducted, I believe that these attachment styles are rooted in all of the mental health issues, the psychiatric issues that we see today, the DSM-5 textbook kinds of things that are taking place. I believe that they're rooted in attachment styles and the neuroscientific realities. And there has to be a way to interface those. And I believe that today is the day to do that. So this is my challenge for my viewing audience, is that in these upcoming videos, I will present more and more of what I believe is a neuroscientific way to understand the nervous system and to see how it works, to avoid reductionism, to avoid reification, and to teach us the skills that we need to know to create that neural integration upstairs, downstairs, so we don't have overproduction of pumpkin cheesecakes, or we don't have an underproduction of those good fruit and of course cakes and pies that we're looking for. But again, and seriously speaking though, without this integration on this neuroscientific level, then we are going to experience medical problems, we're going to experience relational problems, we're going to experience personal problems, unless we have an integration, or what I call a talking cure relational approach. According to the World Health Organization, as I mentioned before in the past videos, that by the year 2005, there's going to be in the next 5 years, then the number one problem in the world will be more and more cancers, more and more struggles like that. But then also in the next few years, we're also going to see that depression, anxiety attacks will be the number two problem in the world, according to the World Health Organization. So let's not be surprised, because within the next 2 to 5 years, we're going to see more and more people getting sicker. And I believe at the heart of it, it's because of dysregulation. There's not an integration on the upstairs and downstairs of the nervous system. And that once these medical systems become automated, then we have a problem. As NASA would say, Houston, we have a problem. Houston, we have a problem. Today is the most exciting time to be seeing a doctor like me to create a rewiring process in my life and in your life. If I can be of any help, give me a call, find me on the internet, check out the two books, The Talking Cure, and I will keep you posted in these upcoming videos as to where to go from here. Thank you very much for viewing. See you soon.